We've only one bedroom, but that's rather curious. It's got a bed which is 20 feet wide.
I was doing a bed full of foreigners at the Victoria Palace with Terry Scott, and we were rehearsing Terry and June for television. So the day was rehearsing television, but we both sort of stood behind a door before we made our entrance, you know. What are we doing?
You'll have gathered from the inimitable voice that I'm talking to June Whitfield, the wonderful June Whitfield, who is indeed a national treasure. And thank you so much for inviting us to your lovely home to have this chat today.
Not a bit. Delighted to see you, David.
Move over.
Right shower we're in with. I said, sorry I didn't get in last night, darling.
Oh, didn't you, darling? Somebody did.
You were talking about pantomime. Oh, yes, you are.
Oh, yes, I was. Not anymore.
You, one of the first things you did, I think, in your pantomime, I'm looking at some of the wonderful billings that you have here in your home, and I see one here, Bradford Alhambra, which is a wonderful theatre, Wilfred Pickles and June Whitfield and Cinderella. So I guess that you were Buttons and Cinders.
Yes.
So that's you were
1948, something like that. 47 and 48, I think. I did pantomime with Wilfred, yes.
I bet it was a long run in those days.
Oh, till Easter?
Easter, yes.
Yes.
Did you enjoy it?
Well, I was young. Yeah. I mean, you know, the thought of it now.
Hard work.
Before I got there.
Well, nowadays they do three shows. Sometimes on a Saturday, can you imagine that? But you would do too. You'd do a matinee and then an evening show, and as you say,
I think every day.
Every day,
a matinee, yes. And an evening, yes.
Yeah, that was a fantastic theatre. I remember doing Bradford Alhambra with the terracotta exterior and those wonderful turrets that it had. You know, just one of those great theatres.
Well, he was a great presenter, wasn't he, Francis Laidler? But, of course, you did get, towards the end, you got some very strange audiences and a lot of children. And, really, they weren't particularly interested in the love story.
No.
No.
They loved the comedy.
Yes. And when Cinders was sitting on her own and the ugly sister had gone to the ball, you know, she had a thing to say, you know, alas, poor me, left lonely and forlorn. All the others to the ball have gone.
Oh.
And so one afternoon I just said, alas, poor me, left lonely and forlorn, whilst all the others to the ball have gone. Nobody laughed except me. They don't listen.
Did you do it in your F voice, as in Ron and F?
No,
sounded
no.
A little bit like it there, actually.
She hadn't happened then.
No, of course. I just wonder if that was the, you know, the inspiration for that later on.
No, it was just sheer boredom, and I thought, you know, if they're all eating oranges and drinking juice and running up and down the aisles, they won't care.
No.
Could have said anything.
You were a good... Pete Murray was telling me, our mutual friend Pete Murray was telling me the other day that you're a very, very good singer. Do you remember what you sang in Cinderella? Do you remember the songs that you sang? What do you sing in the kitchen scene, for example? Do you remember
that? Oh, my goodness. No, I was very lucky. Had a lovely prince, Fay Lenore, who's still... We keep in touch every Christmas. But I could never get the high notes, and Faye used to take them.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah, it was great.
Yeah.
So you
mimed it, did you, really? And she sang it, and you...
No, it was the song was...
She took them over.
My love is only for you, my darling, for you, just you.
Mm-hmm. Let's go back to the beginning of the story, because I know that your parents were very keen for you to go into show business. And
oh,
I think your mother was.
I don't know about my dad.
No, your mother was an actress, wasn't she?
No, my mother was an amateur actress.
Amateur actress, yeah.
Wanted to be an actress, but her father wouldn't let her because he said, no, they're all, rogues and vagabonds. You don't want to get tied up with that lot. So she went to the Admiralty, where she said things went on there that, were far worse than anything that went on.
In show business, yeah.
In show business.
Do you think he was right that, looking back, do you think that the business is full of rogues and vagabonds and has been?
No more than any other business.
No, no.
No more than any other group of people, really.
No.
No.
Some baddies, but lots of goodies as well.
Yes, yeah. Yes.
Who are you? Who've been your favourite people that you've loved working with most?
Oh, golly. Well, working for Noel Coward was marvellous. It was a splendid time in the 70s. I think we went to his first night at the Café de Paris doing his solo, and of course he was marvellous. And I just admired him tremendously because he knew everybody's job better than they did. The musicians, the technicians, he was so knowledgeable and mainly always right.
Yes. Yeah.
And it was great. And I asked him one time, I said, would it be all right, Master, everybody called him Master, if I wore a fringe? And he said, good idea. It'll hide that vast expanse of forehead. Well, you've got to like a man who's nothing like that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Now, you went to RADA, in fact. You and Pete were there at the same time.
Yes, but we weren't in the same stream or whatever it's called.
No.
I think Pete was sort of one of those who went up on the roof bomb watching. And a lot of the girls went up there, but I was never asked, actually, which I'm quite pleased about, because I wouldn't have enjoyed it very much, sitting up there in the cold, waiting for a bomb to drop.
Absolutely. Let Pete do that, and you concentrate on the acting. What was it like for people who've not been at RADA? I mean, that was obviously a wonderful training for what you were going to do.
Well, it was during the war, and there was a great shortage of chaps, of course. I think Brian Forbes was in my lot, Miriam Carlin, Gwen Cheryl, various folk who went on to do other
yes,
things.
Yes, yeah.
And it was fun. And, of course, what we were doing was far more important than the war.
Of course. It was show business. Theatre.
We all used to meet in a coffee shop. And I don't think anybody ever mentioned the war. It was all about who was doing what and what are you playing, and that's dreadful.
London Pride has been handed down to us. London Pride is a flower that's free. London Pride means our own dear town to us, and our pride it forever will be. Whoa, Liza, see the Costa barrows, the vegetable marrows and the fruit piled high. Oh, Liza, little London sparrows, Covent Garden Market where the costers cry. Cockney feet mark the beat of history, every street pins a memory down. Nothing ever could override the pride of London town.
When you left RADA, what was the first job you had? Do you remember that?
Yes, I do, because there was an actor called David Horn. Do you remember him?
Mm-hmm.
He was in Pink String and Sealing Wax. Anyway, it was coming to an end, and he and his wife, Anne Farrah, used to form a little company when David had earned a bit of money doing something or other. And he wanted me to play Margaret in Dear Brutus. Goodness knows why, but he did. So he got me a job of assistant stage manager at the Duke of York's Theatre to just carry on the couple of weeks before it ended. So that was the first job, assistant stage manager.
Now, you've always loved radio. Radio is where we are today.
Yes, of course.
And, of course, back in the 1950s, it was Take It From Here, which was a huge radio
show.
Wasn't
that lucky?
Wasn't that lucky?
I had been doing so much theatre that when the phone rang and it said, you know, Frank Muir here or something, and I said, oh, yes, you know, and I'm the Queen of Sheba. And no, it is, it's Frank and Dennis. And we want you to come and give an audition. And it turned out that my name had been given to them with a load of others. And Frank always said, you know, they sort of ran his finger down or a pin or something, said, oh, let's have a look at her. And so that was my audition at Aeolian Hall with Alma Cogan. Oh. And we both did sketches and we both sang songs. And quite rightly, Alma got the songs.
And you got the sketches. Notably, of course, Ron and F.
Oh, yes.
Now, how that came about? Obviously, it was Frank Muir and Dennis Norton.
Fantastic writing.
Yeah.
And I just loved their humour. And it's so very sad that Dennis has recently died. I know he was 96, but...
Mr. Glum!
Hello!
Can you come in for a sec?
Hey, I'm busy. I've got no time to come in here for sex. I got Mrs. Glum upstairs with a shocking bad cold. I just took her temperature with that thermometer what she bought for cooking.
Well, is it high?
Well, according to that, she's flaky pastry.
What do you remember of Dennis and working with him?
They were both so kind and encouraging, everything that we'd want writers to be, and funny. The things they came up with, like with Ron and Eth, was you know, Eth would say, oh, Ron, is there anything about me that you don't like? No, Eth. Oh, there must be something, Ron. No, Eth. Oh, Ron, nobody's perfect, beloved. You are, Eth. Oh, Ron, there must be one teeny-weeny thing about me that you don't like. Well, there is one thing, Eth. Oh, what's that then, Ron? You're a bit ugly. I mean, that is the sort of stuff they wrote.
Fantastic. Ron and of course, Ron was Dick Bentley.
Yes.
Yeah.
And very funny.
Yeah.
I mean, he was the maker of the laughs, really.
Mm.
And S was the feed.
Oh, Ron. Isn't it nice sitting here on the sofa quietly doing the crossword together? Fancy you finishing your copy of the crossword already, and I've hardly started. You are clever, aren't you, Ron?
Yes, Eth.
I must just check if I've got some of my answers right. Ron, what have you put down for eight across, beloved?
Eight across, flobbergob.
Flobbergob? I've never heard of that word, Ron.
Neither have I, Eth.
Oh, Ron, the idea is you put down real words. You mustn't just put down anything.
Hello, hello, hello. I want to get me a spare pair of braces and a walnut.
What for, Mr. Glum?
That blasted tabby cat's in among my cabbages again. I'll have to... Here, what's this you two are busy on? A crossword puzzle? Oh, I love crosswords. How are you getting on?
Not very well, Dad. Eth says my flobbergob is derelict.
Wow, we're none of us getting any younger.
No, Mr. Glum, Ron just hasn't got the hang of it at all. He puts down words that don't even exist.
Oh, well, now, let's see if I can help then. What's this here? Seven across, opposite of first. Well, that's simple enough. Hunger.
Hunger? But there's only room for... for four letters?
Well, write small then.
Wonderful times when everybody listened to the radio.
Absolutely.
And you had all the comedians with their catchphrases like, "Can I do you now, sir?" But they were wonderful, and everybody loved those catchphrases and went round and saying them and waiting for people to say them on the radio.
Yes.
And when they did, they fell about.
Well, funnily enough, the you know, take it from here with the Glums, Oh Ron didn't really get any reaction to start with. And after about the third series,
yes,
they began to laugh. It's
That's
extraordinary.
Right. Yeah.
And, of course, that doesn't happen now. Things don't get that sort of chance, do they?
No. Things in our business have changed a lot.
Oh, how?
Now, you've worked with so many comedians, and Roy Hudd actually has called you the comic's tart.
Thank you, dear. Yes, I know. Yeah, well, it's quite right. I have served many of them.
You certainly have. And let's talk about Roy, because what a lovely man.
Oh.
He came to your 90th birthday party,
which was indeed a fabulous
bash that we came along to.
I saw him only the other day, yes.
And the news headlines ran, another long-running series.
Yes.
And you appeared on that and, of course, did a wonderful impersonation of the Prime Minister, Margaret Thatcher.
Well, I don't know that I could do it now. But it worked very well at the time because we were in pantomime and I said to Roy, what's happening to you next? And Roy said, we've tried everyone. So I gave him a filthy look and said, you know, you haven't tried me. He said, no, but you have to impersonate politicians. You know. I said, oh, I see. So that matinee, the fairy in the pantomime is conducting a fight. And so the fairy comes on and says, she's organising the fight. She says, go to your corners, and when you hear the bell, you come out fighting. And Roy said from across the stage, you got the job. Which was lucky, as she was the only person I could do.
Well, Roy, of course, it was fabulous, wasn't he, as Flanagan and Allen.
Oh, yes.
Was that with Bernie Winters, I think, wasn't it? The two of them together? He was wonderful. Wonderful as...
Oh, yes. Yes, I did see it, and it was. Yeah. It was very, very good.
Very, very funny man. Let's talk about other funny men that you've worked with. Let's talk about Bob Monkhouse.
Oh, Bob, well...
Do you remember about Bob?
He was a machine, wasn't he? What a marvellous brain to have. Although it wasn't, because sometimes there was so much going on in it... He had to have a rest, you know, hadn't been knocked out for a while to let his mind settle down. But yes, I mean, he was so quick on the uptake, had an answer to everything.
Great writer, of course, as well as comedian.
A very, very talented man.
Yes, yes. Did you ever see him live? Did you see him, his cabaret show?
I don't think I did.
Wonderful.
Yes.
He would do about 15 minutes at the start of the show on the person who was running the place that he was at.
Yes.
No notes. He'd find out about it.
Yes.
So the act was always different, never the same
twice.
And
hold it in there.
Yeah, incredible retention.
That's why he occasionally blew up, yes. He had so much information.
Did you work with him on Carry On films?
No. I did his television show.
Yeah.
With Dennis Goodwin, I did a series, a couple of series, I think, with them.
Mm. Now, of course, we have to talk about Terry Scott.
Oh, yes, of course.
First of all, there was Happy Ever After, and then it became Terry and June.
That's right.
And I remember you telling me once before that Terry used to give you directions about how you might do your lines.
Oh, occasionally, not often.
Occasionally,
but,
advice, perhaps.
Advice.
Yes.
And he was quite knowledgeable.
Yeah.
And, you know, when you say this, why don't you do this, or whatever it is, I say, oh, quite right, Terry. And then I'd do it exactly the same way, and he'd say, that's better.
Did you become almost like a sort of husband and wife?
Well, people thought we were married.
Yes, people thought you
definitely
were.
Definitely. Yeah. I can remember, being collected one morning for filming at about 6 o'clock or something, and the driver said, Tim, my husband, answered the door, and the driver said, I quite expected Terry Scott to answer the door. I said no, because Terry used to say at the warm-up, people would ask how we got on, and Terry would say, we get on very well, but nothing we wouldn't do for each other. I do nothing for her, and she does nothing for me.
It's a good old line, isn't it?
It's a good old line.
£5 this lot came to, £5.
Look, I'm not denying it, though.
Ah, no, but you asked me where all the money goes, and I'm telling you.
All I'm saying is we've got to economise.
Well, will you tell me how to economise?
Look, just calm down. Will you sit down for 5 minutes? We'll get a paper and pencil and work out calmly and sensibly where all the money goes. Now, what are you doing?
I'm looking for a pencil.
Look, sit down. Sit down. Why have you never got any pencils? I bring pencils home.
I had to go out and buy one the other day, and it cost 5 new pence. That's 1 shilling. For a pencil?
Well, I can bring your pencils home from the office. I mean, that's where you waste your money, see?
Well, because I buy things and you steal them.
I don't steal them, I'm issued with them.
Yes, well, when I'm issued with groceries, I'll start economising.
Let's go through the shopping, let's see what we want, okay? Okay, come on, see.
Right, butter?
Yes, fine, yes.
Cheese?
Yes, go.
Eggs?
Yes.
Sausages?
Yes, mm-hmm.
Baked beans?
Yes.
Mm. Gravy browning?
Yes, great, what? Mm?
Gravy browning.
Well, great. What do we need that for?
Need what for?
Well, gravy browning.
For browning the gravy.
Yeah, I mean, why do I have to have brown gravy? Why can't we have grey-coloured gravy? I mean, free from artificial colouring matter. I mean, you never know what's in that much.
Oh, it's only burnt sugar.
Yeah, what? Burnt sugar?
Yes.
Well, what are you buying burnt sugar for? I mean, you ought to be able to burn a bit of sugar. Oh, God, blimey. Last week you burnt the old blooming Sunday dinner, didn't
that
you?
That was the oven. I keep telling you we need a new
oven.
Never mind
that. From now on, we shall cut out gravy browning.
Let's talk some more names. Frankie Howard.
Oh, Frankie Howard. I loved Frank. He was such an extraordinary mixture. In a way, he hated what he did. He was terribly nervous. But, of course, once he got on, he was absolutely fine. But it was a struggle for him, I think.
Very complex character.
Very complex character, yes.
You made a record together.
Oh, yes. Well, Gorton Simpson rang one day and said, do you know the record of Je T'aime? And I said, no. And they said, well, we're doing one with Frankie Howard. And would you like to be in it? I said, of course, I'd love to do a record with Frankie Howard. So I get there, and they said... Now, you don't know this. I said, no. So they said, well, we'll play it, give you an idea.
The original by Serge Gainsbourg and Jane Birkin, yeah.
So when it finished, I said, I suppose I'm the heavy breathing. They said, yes. So that was all I knew about it, really.
Well, I must say you did it very well.
Yeah.
I think we should hear it now. So let's hear June and Frankie Howard and Up Je T'aime.
What?
Hmm? Oh, we should.
Oh, give over. Not again. Do you know what time it is? It's 3:30.
No.
Oh, get off. Now, look, stop that. What earth's got into you? It's not Friday, is it?
Oh, Sherry.
Oh, look, cut that out. Mm. Pull yourself together, woman. Look, control yourself. And get back on your own side. I've got to be on the first tee at 6:30.
Oh, Je T'aime. Je T'aime. Oh,
speak English, woman. Whatever's the matter with you?
Oh.
Here. Leave my scarf alone. Oh. Get your hands off. Look, if I go down and make you a cup of cocoa, will you go back to sleep?
Because Je T'aime, mon amour.
All right. But look, don't go mad. I'm getting on a bit now, you know. Hang on, wait a minute. I'll just put my glasses on. Oh, they're nice. Where did you get those?
Here.
Put that light out. What are you thinking of?
I want to look at you.
Don't be disgusting. I knew I should have taken you to see old Calcutta.
Oh,
wait a minute, wait a minute. Wait for me.
Oh.
Here, be careful. Mummy cartilage.
Oh.
Oh, now look what you've made me do. My foot's gone right through the sheet. That's your fault. Why don't you cut your toenails? Oh, look at the size of that hole. You'll have to stitch it up in the morning. I suppose you could send them back. They're still under guarantee.
Oh, mon amour.
It's no good. You're wasting your time. You'll have to start again.
Je t'aime. Je t'aime.
Oh, dear.
Mon amour.
Did you set that alarm?
Oh, yes. Yes.
Because if you didn't and I'm late, I'll never get a game. They start cleaning up before dawn.
Oh, maintenant. Viens.
Do you know Arthur went round in 89 last week? That's not bad for a bloke with one arm. Oh, yes. He's playing very well, he is. Mind you, I must say it was neck and neck up until the 17th. Then I took a 7-iron. I got underneath it. Here, what are you doing?
Oi.
What?
If you two don't keep quiet, I'm getting out of this bed and I'm going to sleep in the other room.
Oh, I'm sorry, Arthur. You see, you've woken Arthur up now.
Je t'aime, je t'aime.
Leave him alone, Mavis. Mavis, we're off the tea at 6:30. Mavis!
Oh, je t'aime.
Oh.
That wasn't me, that was Arthur. Oh, I think I'm going to beat him tomorrow. Well, good night, Arthur. Good night, Mavis.
Good night, Frank. Oh. Je t'aime. Oh, oui, je t'aime. Tu vas et tu viens. Entre mes
Oh, dear. I'm not putting up with this. I'm going into the other room. Oh, she's such a terrible singer.
June Whitfield is my very special guest on the programme today, and it's wonderful to have you here at Christmas time. What does Christmas mean to you, June?
Well, over a number of years, it's meant pantomime and one day off.
Yes. Precious day off.
Precious day off. Mm. And what Christmas really means, what I like it to mean, is family, you know. So everybody gets together, but that's not always possible.
Now, talking of family, your daughter Susie was born in 1960. How did you manage to combine a very busy career and a lot of travelling with being a mum?
I think you'd have to ask her. She, I don't know, it sort of worked out. And I know one time when Susie was very small and we were both watching television together and I was on it, and Susie suddenly sort of looked up and said, "And then Mummy comes home to Susie." I said, "Yes, dear, that's exactly right."
Now, she's an actress now.
She did have a go. She was very good and enjoyed it, but she is not somebody who likes waiting about. She gets bored, you know, she must do something. And she's very bright, and she took it upon herself to take an MA in museums and art, which she absolutely loves. And she's done it, and she has sent in her, I think it's called a dissertation, which is an awful lot of writing. So we wait to hear the results.
So she's had a change of career.
Absolutely, at the minute, yes. She likes working, and she likes having something to achieve, you know.
Now, we talked about your singing earlier, and you're kind of put that down, but actually you are a good singer, and you sang with Ian Charlson in a Royal Night of 100 Stars. Do you remember that?
I certainly did. Yeah. I remember it well. He died very young, didn't he?
Did he?
Yes.
Yeah. When you're listening to music, who are the people you like to listen to?
Well, I'm stuck in the 40s, really. It's Frank Sinatra. And it's Dean Martin.
Wonderful. Let's play something by Sinatra. What would you fancy? Favourite track?
How about Come Fly With Me?
Oh, lovely.
Come Come fly with me, let's fly away. If you can use some exotic booze, there's a bar in far Bombay. Come fly with me, let's fly away. Come fly with me, let's float down to Peru. In Llama Land, there's a one-man band, and he'll toot his flute for you. Come fly with me, let's take off in the blue. Once I get you up there, where the air is rarefied, we'll just fly starry-eyed. Once I get you up there, I'll be holding you so near. You may hear angels cheer, 'cause we're together. Weather-wise, it's such a lovely day. Just say the words and we'll beat the birds down to Acapulco Bay. It's perfect for a flying honeymoon, they say. Come fly with me, let's fly away. Once I get you up there, where the air is rarefied, we'll just glide starry-eyed. Once I get you up there, I'll be holding you so near. You may hear angels cheer, 'cause we're together. Weather-wise, it's such a lovely day. You just say the words and we'll beat the birds down to Acapulco Bay. It's perfect for a flying honeymoon, they say. Come fly with me, let's fly, let's fly. Pack up, let's fly away.
Frank Sinatra, Come Fly With Me, chosen by my special guest today, June Whitfield. Now, we're talking about some of the people that you've worked with. I've got so many comics that you work with. And, of course, you were the nurse in the famous blood donor test with Tony Hancock. Now, what was he like to work with?
Great to work with. Absolutely fine. But, of course, he was really a depressive. And he could never settle for his success. He always thought he should be doing something better. And he got rid of everybody who wrote for him and everything. And it was sad. And one time, I know I did a television series with him. One time we were waiting for our cue for something, and Tony sort of said, "I don't know, what's it all about, eh?" And I said, "I don't know, Tony, but we're on in 2 minutes."
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, nurse. I've come in answer to your advert on the wall next to the Eagle Laundry in Pelham Road.
An advert? Pelham Road?
Yes, your poster. You must have seen it. As a nurse pointing at you, a Red Cross lady, actually, I believe, with a moustache and a beard. Well, penciled in, of course. You must know it. It's one of yours. It's next to Chamberlain Must Go, just above the cricket stumps. It says your blood can save a life.
Oh, I see. You wish to become a blood donor.
I certainly do. I've been thinking about this for a long time. No man is an island, young lady. To do one unselfish act with no thought of profit or gain is the duty of every human being. Something for the benefit of the country as a whole. What should it be, I thought? Become a blood donor or join the Young Conservatives? But as I'm not looking for a wife and I can't play table tennis, here I am. A body full of good British blood and raring to go.
Yes, quite. Well, now, would you sit down and I'll just take a few particulars. May I have your name?
Yes, Hancock, Anthony Hancock. Twice candidate for the county council elections, defeated. Honsec British Legion Earls Court Branch, treasurer of the darts team and the outings committee.
Yes, I only want the
Yeah, well,
name.
We're going to Margate this year by boat if there's any young nurses like yourself.
Nationality?
Ah, you've got nothing to worry about there. It's blood you're thinking about, isn't it? British. British. Undiluted for 12 generations. 100% Anglo-Saxon with perhaps just a dash of Viking. But nothing else has crept in. Now, anybody who gets any of this will have nothing to complain about. There's aristocracy in there, you know. You want to watch who you're giving it to. It's like motor oil. It doesn't mix, if you get my meaning.
Mr. Hancock, when a blood transfusion is being given, the family background is of no consequence.
Oh, come now. Surely you don't expect me to believe that. I mean, after all, East is East,
and
really.
And blood is blood, Mr. Hancock, the world over. It is classified by groups and not by accidents of birth.
I did not come here for a lecture on communism, young lady.
I happen to be a conservative.
Then kindly behave like one, madam.
Have you had any of the diseases on this list?
Show me. How dare you? No, I have not. And especially that one. I've told you before, you've nothing to fear from me. I am perfectly healthy. Fit! Fit! If we'd had our own rocket, I'd have been the first one up there. I had me name down for the blue streak, but no, we missed our chance again. It's not right having these foreigners hurtling round up there. You mark my words.
Blood, Mr. Hancock, blood.
Hmm? Yes. Ah, yes. I beg your pardon, I do get carried away over things like that. It's a sore point with me. Are we ready now, then?
Well, there is just one more thing. Have you given any blood before?
Given, no. Spilt, yes.
Oh.
Yes, there's a good few drops lying about on the battlefields of Europe. Are you familiar with the Ardennes? I well remember von Rundstedt's last push. Tiger Harrison and myself, being in a forward position, were cut off behind the enemy lines. Captain Harrison, I said. Yes, sir, he said. Jerry's overlooked us, I said. Where shall we head for? Berlin, he said. Right, I said. Last one in the Reichstag's a sissy, so we set off. We got there 3 days before the Russians.
You've never been a blood donor before.
No, yes. Well, so, there we were, surrounded by stormtroopers. Kamerad, kamerad, they said.
If you'll just sit over there with the others, Doctor will call you when he's ready.
You once actually said, I've got a quote of yours here, said, the main reason that I've worked for so long is because I'm no trouble.
Yeah, that's true.
So no prima donna. Easy to work with.
Let it brush over me, yes.
Yeah. Absolutely. You've got that lovely sort of laid-back nature, which does help in this business, doesn't
it? Well, yes,
not everybody has
it,
of course, as we know.
But, I've always thought I've worked with so many comics, and I'm there to make them look good. I'm not there to make me look good. I'm very lucky to be in it, you know. I've always had that sort of attitude. And part of it probably is fear. I don't think I've ever been brave enough. I mean, I could never do a stand-up in a million years. I might tell the odd joke.
Yes,
that's about
very
it.
Well. But tough business, though, isn't it, stand-up? It is tough.
Oh, I don't know how they do it.
No.
Yeah.
Drop everything and turn on the old music box. Old memories return on the old music box.
Let's talk some more names. Dick Emery, Benny Hill.
Arthur Askey.
Arthur Askey, of course.
Loved Arthur Askey.
Yeah.
I first saw Arthur, I think my father took me to some do where Arthur was the cabaret. And he sang, you know, something about, oh, what a wonderful thing to be.
A great big grown-up, busy, busy bee.
And then when I worked with him, of course, I loved him. I thought he was delightful.
Yeah. Big-hearted Arthur.
Big-hearted Arthur, yeah. Definitely.
Same off as he was on.
Yes.
Just the same.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
People said that about Harry Secombe. I don't know if you worked with Harry at all. Harry was very funny off.
But only once in a film and not for long, yeah.
Very, very funny off. Sellers? Peter Sellers?
Peter Sellers I worked with, but never got to know.
No.
No.
One believes another complex character. I think so many comedians.
Huh?
No. Oh, were you? You didn't work in separate rooms or anything like that.
Well,
it wasn't one of those.
That sort of thing, yeah.
Yeah. Dick Emery, was he funny?
Oh, Dick Emery was great fun to work with, yes.
Yeah. And Benny Hill? What about Benny?
Benny, yes. Worked with him quite a lot.
Did you? I thought it was terrible when his shows were axed by Thames TV.
Why?
Political correctness, I think. And Benny was very, very upset about that, as I'm sure you know.
I think political correctness has gone out of the window. You cannot make a joke about anybody.
Difficult.
What has happened to our sense of humour?
Difficult, isn't it, without somebody taking offence?
Without somebody taking offence.
Yeah, I know. It's not the friend of comedy, is it?
No.
No friend of comedy.
It certainly isn't. No. I mean, what about that joke I told you that Frank and Dennis wrote about, you know, Ron and S? You know, is there anything about me you don't like? Well, you're a bit ugly.
Yeah.
Now, would that cause offence, do you think? Or
probably
be cut?
There are some people who take offence at almost anything, actually.
Yes.
Somebody I know that you adore is Joanna Lumley.
Oh, I love Jess, of course I do. And what about her Silk Road?
You enjoying it?
Oh, I think it's divine. Yeah. I think it's the best one she's done.
Yeah. What was it like working with her? Pure joy, I would think, wasn't it?
Oh, absolute joy. Yeah. And Jennifer, I mean, you know, the whole of Absolutely Fabulous was tremendous fun. We all enjoyed it.
And you did things like Boomers?
Boomers, yes, yeah.
Yes. Enjoyed that?
Yes, I enjoyed that.
Mm, yeah. I think you were in a wheelchair on that, weren't you, as I remember?
Was,
yes.
With a glass in my hand. And, oh, yes. And, yes, somebody said, I don't think she should have a glass in her hand, you know. I think it was political correctness coming in or something. And I said, why not? She's a drunk.
Was there actually a tipple in it or not? Was there a tipple in the glass?
Don't be daft.
Eh? Not when you're working.
BBC's attempt at whatever.
Cold tea, probably.
Probably, to get the right colour, you know.
Nice gig, being in a wheelchair. You don't have to walk around.
Oh, lovely.
Yeah.
Yes.
Like a rest, really.
Well, that's the only sort of part I could play now. Either in a wheelchair or in a bed, going to sleep.
Well, I'm sure there's still plenty of offers, aren't there, coming along?
No.
Aren't there?
Not really.
Bet there are.
No, no, no.
There will be. There will be.
No. They must have, obviously, as an actress, you must be able to walk about. And I'm not very good at that.
No.
Or standing for any length of time.
Nice seating parts, I think, like a bit like us today, sitting down.
A sitting part?
Sitting part.
Marvellous. Radio, probably even better.
Radio. Now, coming back to radio, of course, you were Miss Marple. Many, which they're running again now on Radio 4, I think. Yes, they're rerunning
them.
So
they did.
Would you get any repeats?
Year, I think.
Get any repeats for that?
Enid Williams directed those.
Yeah.
I based Miss Marple on the fact that she would say, you know, things like, I hope I'm not intruding. And, of course, she always was, you know.
So you don't listen to them now? You don't...
Well, there's too much going on to
too much going
to.
On, yeah. Yeah.
We present June Whitfield as Miss Marple and Francis Matthews as the Reverend Leonard Clement in Agatha Christie's Murder at the Vicarage.
There seems to be no end to the peculiar things that are taking place at St. Mary Mead. First, the murder of Colonel Protheroe in the vicar's study, then Lawrence Redding and Anne Protheroe making false confessions to save one another. And now Dr. Stone, the archaeologist excavating a long barrow on Colonel Protheroe's land, turns out to be an impostor. Everyone is wondering what on earth is going to happen next.
Last year you were made a Dame of the British Empire.
I know.
Long overdue.
Fantastic.
What are your memories of the day when it happened?
Well, I mean, absolutely splendid. And they couldn't have been more friendly or, you know, nicer at Buckingham Palace, because there was somebody there, a young uniformed gentleman, who was there to look after me. And so he hardly left my side, which was absolutely wonderful. Anywhere I had to go, I could hang on to him and get there, you know, which was great. So it all went very well. Prince Charles, because Her Majesty had gone to Hull, wasn't it, an opening of something or other? God knows how she does it. But she had gone overnight on the train, and she'd been giving awards all the week before she went. But I thought, well, obviously she can't be doing me. So it was Prince Charles, and who was quite charming. And that morning, he did 90 people.
Good God.
Now, it's a lot, isn't it?
Yes, it is a lot.
To, you know, for him, standing there, having words to say to everyone, it's a hard job. And
Are you allowed to tell us what he said to you? Are you allowed to reveal that?
I don't know.
He didn't say, have you come far, did he?
No, he didn't say that. He said, it's been a long time coming.
Well, he was right. That's absolutely right. Yes. At least he knew who you were. Probably some of them he didn't know who they were, but he knew who you were, all right.
Well, I think he did, because I had met him before through some charity, I think it was Help the Aged. Mm. He took over from Diana, I think. So I had met him before, but then he's met how many people?
But you've met the Queen quite a few times?
Yes. But I don't think she'd remember.
Oh, of course you would.
I mean, how could she remember? You know, when you've got a million people flowing through your brain. I don't think so.
No, I think she would. Let's have another record. I mean, you mentioned Dean Martin earlier.
Yes.
I have got to tell you, I was very lucky. I saw Dean Martin live in Vegas at the MGM Grand. And I was with Ernie Wise, and we were sitting there watching, and he came up with a drink in his hand. He had the most enormous orchestra you've ever seen, 45-piece orchestra, and he looked at the orchestra and he said, what are these people doing in my bedroom? And Ernie Wise said to me, he said, I don't think he drinks. He said, I think it's a gimmick. He said, nobody could have that perfect timing that he has if he'd been drinking. But he was wonderful, wasn't he, Dean Martin?
Oh, yes.
You loved him.
Oh, yes.
Why don't we play, I'll tell you a track we'll play, I think you'll like this, why don't we play Ain't That a Kick in the Head?
Enjoy it.
How lucky can one guy be? I kissed her and she kissed me. Like the fella once said, ain't that a kick in the head? The room was completely black. I hugged her and she hugged back. Like the sailor said, quote, ain't that a hole in a boat? My head keeps spinning. I go to sleep and keep grinning. If this is just the beginning, my life is gonna be beautiful. I've sunshine enough to spread. It's just like the fella said. Tell me quick, ain't love a kick in the head? Like the fella once said, ain't that a kick in the head? The sailor said, quote, ain't that a hole in a boat? My head keeps spinning. I go to sleep and keep grinning. If this is just the beginning, my life is gonna be beautiful. She's telling me we'll be wed. She's picked out a king-sized bed. I couldn't feel any better, or I'd be sick. Tell me quick, oh, ain't love a kick? Tell me quick, ain't love a kick in the head?
So that was Dean Martin. Ain't that a kick in the head? And my very special guest today is June Whitfield. June, I've been working it out. I wrote it down here somewhere. How many decades you have been in the business? Do you know how many decades you've been in the business?
Well, I left RADA in 1944.
I think it's 8 decades. Isn't that fantastic?
That's marvellous. And they've gone so fast.
And you've worked almost non-stop. You've never stopped.
Well, I did work. I mean, the film I did of Absolutely Fabulous, I was 90. So I've had a pretty good innings.
How has the business changed in the time that
you've
been in it?
Oh, very much, I think.
How would you describe the changes?
I think it has got more money conscious. Everything is done for the least possible amount of money, except, I don't know, and I never know whether television programmes put on what people want or whether it's what they think they should want.
That's interesting.
You know, I mean, everything, every channel, it's either some sex scene or a killing of some kind. And where's the humour gone? You can't really get a good laugh from the television. I mean, I do like people like Michael McIntyre, but some of them just spend the whole time swearing, you know. No tags, no taglines, just finish with an obscene word and get off.
You see, the great comics didn't need to do that, did they?
No.
If you think about the people we've talked about
absolutely.
Today, Ken Dodd, Benny Hill, they were cheeky, Bob Monkhouse, cheeky,
yes.
Saucy,
yes.
But never used...
Not that.
Swear words.
Why do they have to do it?
I don't know. Yeah. You should be the head of comedy and put them in their places, bring back some real comedy.
I don't think I have the capability of doing that.
You
could do it.
The Carry-On films that you were in, I think you did 4 of them.
I did.
They were cheeky, weren't they?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, but
and
never
they
filthy.
Did get a bit more cheeky, I think, as time went by. Mm.
What was it like working on them? Were they were on fairly small budgets.
Tight, and,
yes,
as you might say.
Tight budgets.
Yes, you needed to know what you were doing and
do
it. And if there wasn't anything terribly wrong,
it stayed
that was
in.
It.
Yeah.
It was a lovely story about Barbara Windsor when she was rehearsing a scene that she had to do in a telephone box or something. And she went through it and Peter Ross said, cut. And Barbara said, was that a take? He said, yes. She said, oh, blowers are going to play it posh. Yeah.
June, it's been lovely seeing you today. I think we should... Are you up for a song? We'll do a song together to finish on?
As long as it's one Christmas. I know.
Well, I was thinking of the one that we have sung to each other on New Year's Eve. If
but
you were the only girl and the
we
world...
We haven't had that amount of drink today.
Well, that's true. And nor have the audience.
No.
Either. They haven't either.
How do you know?
Well, all we've had is your
have
lovely
you?
Coffee. Can we sing on a coffee? We'll give it a go. I'll sing the first line, okay? You ready?
Yes.
If you were the only girl in the world.
And you were the only boy.
Nothing else would matter in the world today.
We would... I can't get in your key.
Go on, loving.
We would go on loving in the same old way.
A garden of Eden just made for two.
Nothing to mar our joy.
I would say such wonderful things to you.
There would be such wonderful things to do.
If you were the only girl in the world.
And you happen to be in my key. Oh, dear.